morning. Those of you that are present this morning in the sanctuary, and to those of you that are watching online this morning, we are glad to have you in the house of the Lord this morning, and we're glad that you're worshiping with us this morning also. Just a few announcements this morning. First of all, many thanks to those who have continued their tithes and offerings and have kept up to date on those. And if you have not, then Jerry will have the church address listed on the screen this morning, and we encourage you to do that. Also, we're still collecting items for our United Methodist Corps relief for Christmas shoe boxes, and the list of those items that are needed up on the screen this morning also. So please pay attention to that. If you're here present with us this morning, you've got an orange insert in your bulletin with those items. The Outreach Committee meeting was scheduled for today. It's going to be postponed. It says scheduled, but let's say it's just going to be postponed right now. Birthdays this week. Nell Andrews has one tomorrow. And Caroline Reed and Audrey Burris have one on Tuesday. And Cheryl Shaw has one coming up on Saturday, and so does Henry Nimick. So if you see these people, be sure and wish them happy birthday. Now, to add to your list of those on your prayer list, Beverly Wilkes called me yesterday, and for those of you that are longtime members of this church, you know who I'm referring to, and if you're not, I'll tell you, Wade Wilkes, former pastor of this church some 17 years ago. It's hard to believe it's been that long, but it's been 17 years. And Beverly called me yesterday and said that Wade was in rehab, and the tone of her voice when she first called me almost scared me. I was afraid she had a message that was a lot worse than this one. But Wade fell and broke his arm, and he broke it in between his elbow and his shoulder. And so they've got him in rehab down in Senatobia, and she can talk to him on the phone, but she can't visit him. Now, those two have been together since high school. They've been married 62 years, and they've been together since high school. So it's kind of rough on both of them right now, and he's supposed to be in there for 4 more weeks. I talked to him last night, and he was in pretty good spirits. He was in a lot better spirits than Beverly was, to be honest with you. So I encourage you to put Wade and Beverly on your prayer list this morning. There is one other announcement. Brother Sam's going to take care of that one.
After we do the hymn.
Any other announcements this morning from the congregation? All right, our first hymn this morning is number 57. Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing, and we'll sing verses 1, 2, 3, 4, and 7.
Shall fear your sins more near. Yes, sir.
Amen. Thank you, Jim, for welcoming us and bringing us together into this time of worship in Bethel as well. I do also want to join in with Jim and thanking you all for being here with us today. And all of you who are at home watching there for our live broadcast, please, if you're at home or somewhere you're on your computer, your laptop, iPhone, anything like that, give us a shout out. Let us know, okay, that you're watching. It does my heart good when I go back home this afternoon and I pull this up and I kind of start going through, and I love it when I see your names and your amens and hallelujahs come popping up and your smiley faces. You can skip the frowny ones, but I love the smiley faces too. So anyway, please let us know that you're out there. It means a lot to us, to me and Jerry, as we're putting all this together. As you know, Jim said, we do have one more announcement, and you know what it is concerning, because of what I shared last night, yesterday, with the phone message, and that is simply a request that's come forth now out of our conference office in Jackson through our bishop. Basically, the thing is, he lets us know, and there's a copy of his email on both tables if you'd like to take one with you, but the bottom line is that they're running out of beds, an alarming rate here in Mississippi, and some are having to be sent out of state to get hospital help. And as you know, all these counties, 20, and DeSoto's one of them. And so what he has asked is that although the governor's order, it does not apply to churches, as your Episcopal leader, he's asking us to please adhere to this request. For all churches in the Mississippi Conference to cease and desist all in-person gatherings at church, including drive-in church services, until further notice. And he reminds us that as the body of Christ, it's very important for us to rise up and to set forth a higher standard, not go to a lower one. So we're called to set an example in all this. And so, for this reason, and also for health reasons as well, he is asking that once again we halt the in-house, but we're still going to be doing the Sunday morning live broadcast, and so you're invited to continue to be a part of that. But as a result, we are still having to hold off on trying to get Sunday school started, and we will be stopping the Wednesday night and Thursday morning Bible studies as well, but once again, we'll still continue with broadcasting them live. So for right now, until further notice from our conference office or from the district office, we will be stopping this for a while. But I wanted you to know, I wanted everybody to know that this would be our last one for a few weeks, maybe a month, we don't know. Numbers start going down, I'm sure they'll let us come back together. But I wanted to give you a chance to come one last time in here for a while. So that's why I went on to let everybody know that this would be our last time for a month or so. So anyway, please continue to keep us lifted up in your prayers, each other and the church, as we continue to minister in new ways. So anyway, this will be our last one for a while. Also, no Sunday school starting back, and we will be putting an end to the Wednesday night and Thursday morning Bible studies for this time. And if you have any questions about all this, you can ask me once the service is over. We'll take some time to talk about it in here. And those of you at home, if you have any questions, give us a call here at the church office. We'll be glad to answer them best as I can. Well, as we continue on now into our service, I want to go into our affirmation of faith. It's on number 881 in the back of our hymnals on the screen for each and every one of you. And it is that historic Apostles' Creed, and I always like to remind folks that when we do come to that line that talks about the Holy Catholic Church, it is a small c. And once again, that small c for that Catholic is Latin for universal. We look forward to the day when Jesus comes back, and there's just going to be one church. Everybody before the throne of Christ and before the throne of God. And it's something I can't wait to be a part of one day. And I know that's what we're affirming at this time. So would you please join me? The historic Apostles' Creed, as we affirm our faith together now as the body of Christ. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Now let us continue into one of my favorite parts of our service, is time of prayer. Let's do continue to lift up Brother Wade and Miss Beverly and so many others. Those of you who are here, you do have our list, and I invite you to please take this list with you. Keep it with you so you continue to lay all these family members and friends, place them into the hands of God each day. So please take this list with you and keep it with you throughout this week as we continue to lift up these needs, along with all the other things that are going on in our county, in our state, and also in our nation and around the world. So would you please now join me for a moment? And whatever these needs are, maybe something personal at this moment, would you join me in a time of silent prayer? Beth Ellen's going to play and take us now together to the throne of grace. Gracious loving Heavenly Father, once again we are here now with heads bowed but hearts lifted up into your presence. And we give to you each and every need that you have now placed upon our hearts. There's so many friends, family members, loved ones, church family members, dear God, that are in need of our prayers. And so, dear God, we give them all now to you. And we do it with thankful hearts. Because you are still the God who is sitting on his throne. You're still the one who is in control. You're the one, dear God, who still holds us all in the palm of your loving, life-giving hands. And as we place ourselves in this service now, use everything that is a part of this service today. Those of us who are gathered here and those who are here with us spiritually, bring us all together. Let us feel your presence as we're one with each other, with you. And use it all now to bring us to the foot of the cross of Jesus. And dear God, we give not only ourselves, we continue to give our church to you and all churches as we seek to find new ways to minister and share the gospel of Christ with others. We continue to lift up all of those affected by the COVID-19, but also other illnesses that are out there, dear God. We ask you to bless and touch as only you and you alone can do, while you also give comfort now to all the families that have lost loved ones. And we continue to lift up all those in the medical professions, dear God, not just doctors and nurses, but the office workers, the managers, dear God. We give to you the custodians, the ones that are making sure everything stays clean and sterile, and those that keep the businesses going. We pray for all the essential workers, the frontline workers, as we especially continue to give to you those men and women of our armed forces, those men and women of our fire departments, and we especially at this time pray for all the police officers, in our neighborhood, in our county, our state, in our nation, dear God. And most importantly, dear God, we just pray now and asking you to step forward for us. To know that there are people who have not bowed the knee to Baal, but they are your faithful ones. Like those of us here, dear God, who continue to give all this to you and ask for your help, who continue to cry out, hear our prayers and reveal yourself now in a great and mighty way. Bring healing, not just in this disease, but also in all the hurt, the pain, and the division that is coming up. Bring healing in all these areas now, dear God. As once again, we give all this to you. So come forth now. Reveal yourself in a great and mighty way. As once again now, we place ourselves before your throne by sharing together now the prayer that Jesus himself has given to us. So hear us now as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen and amen. At this time, Jerry now has our special music, a special video he wants to share with all of us at this time.
Cause I'll rise.
Amen. Thank you, Jerry, for putting that video together for us. We appreciate it. And Dawn, I got a special favor to ask of you. When Jerry gets home, give him a big hug for all of us. We can't do it. We can't give him a hug. But Dawn, we need you to do that for us. Give him a hug and a big kiss from me, okay? I want to follow that up now by sharing with you from Peter's first letter to the early church. And I want to read from 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23, and concluding with chapter 2, verse 9. And I want to ask those of you who are here in the sanctuary with me this morning, would you please stand now for the reading of God's holy word? For you have been born again, but not to a life that will quickly end. Your new life will last forever because it comes from the eternal living word of God. As the scriptures say, people are like grass. Their beauty is like a flower in the field. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of the Lord remains forever. And that word is the good news that was preached to you. So get rid of all evil behavior. Be done with all deceit, hypocrisy, jealousy, and all unkind speech. Like newborn babies, you must crave pure spiritual milk so that you will grow into a full experience of salvation. Cry out for this nourishment now that you have had a taste of the Lord's kindness. You are coming to Christ, who is the living cornerstone of God's temple. He was rejected by the people, but he was chosen by God for great honor. And you are living stones that God is building into his spiritual temple. What's more, you are his holy priest. Through the mediation of Jesus Christ, you offer spiritual sacrifices that please God. As the scriptures say, I am placing a cornerstone in Jerusalem, chosen for great honor. And anyone who trusts in him will never be disgraced. Yes, you who trust him recognize the honor God has given him, but for those who reject him, the stone that the builders rejected has now become the cornerstone. And he is the stone that makes people stumble, the rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they do not obey God's word, and so they meet the fate that was planned for them. But you are not like that. For you are a chosen people. You are royal priests, a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God, for he called you out of the darkness into his wonderful light. May God bless the reading and the hearing of his holy word. And all of God's people together said, amen. Amen. God bless you and thank you. Those here, please be seated. Let me ask you a question this morning. Have you ever had someone in your life that knew exactly what buttons to push? That knew exactly what buttons to push, not just to get you upset about something, but to do what we call make you lose your religion? There was once a pastor who arrived at his church office one morning to discover that there was a dead mule in the church courtyard. Well, immediately he called the police department and he told them about the dead mule. Well, they told him that he needed to contact the health department. So he called the health department, and when he told them about the dead mule, they told him he needed to contact the sanitation department. So he called the sanitation department, and in turn, they then told him, after he explained about the mule, that he needed to first of all call the mayor. Now, the thing is this, the pastor, he didn't really want to call that mayor because he had already had a couple of encounters with this man. And each time that he and the mayor were together, the mayor always ended up in a bad mood, and he became generally very hard to work with. But worst of all, every time they were together, by the time they finished whatever they were talking about, this mayor began to push the preacher's buttons, causing him to end up saying something that after he said it, he immediately would regret it. Well, he took a deep breath, and he called the mayor. When he told the mayor about the dead mule, immediately he lit into the preacher, started hollering, complaining at him about him. He is interrupting very important city business, and he had no time for this foolishness. And he just really tore into the preacher. And then he concluded everything by then asking him, but tell me, why did you call me? Isn't it your job to bury the dead? And the preacher, he then responded before he had time to stop himself. And he said, yes, your honor, it is my job to bury the dead, but I always like to notify the next of kin first. In our scripture reading for today, I shared with you a very small portion that comes from a much larger section here in 1 Peter. A section that goes back, starts in verse 13, often referred to simply as a call to holy living. Now, it is in the passage, the small portion that I shared with you starting in verse 23, that I believe that Peter is now in his own way drawing our attention, seeking to draw our attention to something that too many times gets pushed to the side and then eventually gets forgotten about within our lives as Christians. And the thing that too often gets pushed to the side and then forgotten, it is one very simple, but also one very great and important, powerful truth. And that truth is this, that when you are born again, that when you become a Christian, when you bow your head and you ask Christ to come into your life, to forgive you of your sins, to come and be your Lord and your Savior, that from that moment on, you are now called to live your life in a way that is completely different from the life that you lived before you were saved. Or simply put like this, once you ask Christ into your heart, you are now called to live a totally different life than the old sinful life that you used to live. But what Peter is saying, we have to understand, doesn't end there either. Because you and I, yes, we're not just called to now live in a different way. You and I are also supposed to be living in a very specific way. We're to live our lives as a Christian also in a very specific way, living our lives upon the living cornerstone of God, living upon the life of Jesus himself. And in living upon that cornerstone, you and I are become a living stone ourselves. You and I are supposed to be living stones, living upon the cornerstone, and in turn, helping one another. Helping one another then to grow within the faith of God. But this is where the problem comes in. You see, there are a lot of people out there, out in the world, and there are people in the church who profess to be a Christian. But they're still doing everything that they can to hold on to the old life that they used to live. Or in other words, they're out there who are claiming, they're claiming to live a holy life, but in reality, they are doing nothing more than this. They're doing nothing more than living the life of a dead stone. And what Peter wants us to understand, that you and I are called to be more than just a dead stone. We're called to be more than just a dead stone in this world. And to help us, he now shares three things with us in this passage to help us to this holy life. But really, that's not true, folks. I need to be honest with you. Because Peter is doing more than sharing three things with us today. The truth is this, he's giving us three warnings. He is giving you and me and all of us that are together at this time, He is giving us three warnings about living the life of a dead stone. So what are these three warnings? Well, first off, Peter wants us to understand that you and I are called to do more than just give lip service to God. Okay? We're called to do more than just give lip service to God. That as Christians, we are called to do more. We are called to give life service. Life service to God. This is our whole idea, not just as Christians, but also being Methodists. It's the idea of what we call social holiness. You see, in social holiness, we believe that, yes, we are to be Christ, but more importantly, we are to give Christ away. But we're to give Christ away more than just using our words. You see, we are called to be Christ in this world. But more importantly, we're called to give Christ, to give Christ away by getting out of our comfort zones and becoming the physical hands, arms, feet, legs, body of Christ in this world for those who do not know Him. We are called to do this, to give life service to God. Why? Because you see, Jesus came to this world, didn't He? And He told us. The scriptures are full. God Himself has told us. The gospels are full of how Jesus came and He told us about God's love for us and God's desire to forgive us of all of our sins. But did it stop there? No. Because after He told us, He then went to the cross and He showed us. He went to the cross and He showed us how much God loves us. He went to the cross and He showed us what God was willing to do to bring forgiveness into this world and into our lives. We are called to give life service. That means then, friends, that when we are trying to share God, to share Jesus, we are called to do more than just simply stand there and say, God loves you and so do I. Or to say, Jesus loves you, don't ever forget that. When we say, God loves you, the thing we're supposed to do is go out there and show it. Show that love at work in their lives. When somebody does something to hurt us, to hurt somebody that we love, and they come and they ask for forgiveness. Well, even if they don't ask for forgiveness, we're still called to go out there and show forgiveness. To show what true forgiveness is in our lives. To show the same forgiveness that Jesus has given to you and me. But friends, we got to do more than just give Him lip service. We are called to give life service to God. That's the first warning. Secondly, Peter then tells us that we must get rid of all malicious, evil behavior. Now for this, Peter uses the Greek word kakia. Now kakia is the general overall word used to describe every kind of evil thought, word, and action. That's why Peter says you have to do it all. Because you see, that is why when Jesus came and when we come to Him as a result of His coming to that cross and we ask Him to forgive us of our sins, that we need to ask Him to forgive us of all of our sins. Not say, just forgive me of these sins, but I'm going to hang on to these. You can't just give Him a piece of your life or a piece of your own sinful life and say, you can have this, but I'm going to hang on to this in my life. No, friends, it has to be not just all your life. It has to be all your sins. Why do we need to make sure we're doing this with our lives? Why do we need to give it all? Well, see, Peter also wants us to understand this, that when you ask Jesus, when you ask Him to take away, forgive you of all your sins, but then you turn around and you make that choice to still hang on to some sinful pieces, some sinful parts of your life. And what Peter wants you to understand is this, that when you do things like this, you are playing a game with God. And the bottom line is this, friends, it's a game that you will lose. That when you stand before him, as Peter talks about here, it's a game that you're going to lose. And trust me, he's not going to take all your Monopoly money away. He's not going to take the game pieces and put it in a board bin and then set the game on top of a shelf there in the closet. No, it's going to cost you. And it's a steep price you're going to have to pay for the game you lost. And that cost is going to be eternity. Because you're going to have to spend eternity then separated from him. What causes this? Because you see, when you do this, when you only want to give parts of your life to him, then what you're actually saying is that what Jesus did on the cross wasn't complete, it's actually incomplete. You're saying that it's not enough, that it's not powerful enough to take away all your sins. And when you do this, you fall into one of the gravest sins of all time. One of the greatest sins, Jesus himself warns us about this. We studied it in John chapter 8. Don't believe me, go back and check some of our past Bible studies from John 8. Jesus himself is warning us that this grave sin is not the sin of not believing in him. The grave sin that can cause this is the sin of not believing who Jesus says that he is. The sin of not believing who Jesus says that he is. And Jesus said, I came to die for the sins of the world. I came to die for all of your sins. But if you're holding back, you may believe that Jesus is the Son of God, but you don't believe in who he says that he is. You have to give it all to him. Which then brings us to the third warning. Peter then warns us about three major things that we still want to hang on to the most. Now, before I say anything else, please, please, please do not shoot the messenger. Do not shoot the messenger, because the three things I'm about to point out are not little things like, well, I've only been to church 2 out of 4 Sundays this month, or I didn't pay my tithe last month, but somehow I'll make it up. Or when I got to Sunday school, I told the Sunday school teacher that I'd read my lesson, but that really wasn't true. That's not what we're talking about here. So do not shoot the messenger. Because the three things that Peter taught are simply this: jealousy, backstabbing, and hypocrisy. The sad part is, I know I don't have to identify any of those three things, do I? But what you need to understand is this, that I believe that for Peter, hypocrisy is the worst one. Hypocrisy is the worst because through his own personal life, his own personal experience, he has come now to understand that with the Christian, it is much more than just simply saying one thing, saying one thing with your mouth, while at the same moment actually meaning something else in your heart and something else in your spirit. No, for Peter, hypocrisy comes about when you know what God calls you to do. When God is commanding you to go forth and show his acts of love, grace, and mercy. When he is saying to go forth and show his acts of forgiveness. But as he is calling you to do these things, instead, you make the choice to go forth and show acts of anger and hatred. To go forth and show acts of unforgiveness. To show acts of jealousy and backstabbing and hypocrisy. You see, you know what you're supposed to do, but you don't do it. You're being hypocrite in your life with Christ. The thing is, how do we overcome this? Well, simple. You have to stop pretending to be good and just start actually being good. What do I mean when I say stop pretending to be good and start actually being good? Well, it's simple. It's about being the person that Jesus died on the cross for us to be. To be the person that Jesus died on the cross for you to be, which is one that lives out the same acts of love, grace, mercy, and forgiveness that he's already given to you, to give it to others. And so we have these three warnings, but praise God, Peter's not finished, because he then steps forward and he now shares with us a word of advice. Some beautiful advice that he gives to us there in chapter 2, verse 2, because it's here then that Peter is telling us that to be a true living stone for God, there's something then very specific we now have to do. What is it? Simple, you must crave spiritual milk. But now if you're like me, you got to ask that question then, right? What in the world does Peter mean when he says spiritual milk? Well, I'm just going to be honest with you and tell you that for me personally, I believe that he is talking about the living Word of God. And the reason why I say that is simple, because you see, in this message, and a part of this message as Peter is writing, he uses the common Greek word logos. And logos is the Greek word for word. It's the word for word. But not just that, it's the word for anyone. It actually means anyone's word. But if you look a little closer, you look in chapter 1, verse 25. There, Peter uses another Greek word for word. There, he uses the word haranma. And haranma means this. It is the word spoken directly by God himself. It is the word that can claim God as its author. Which then brings us to this bigger question. Why is this important then? Why is this important for us as Christians then to know? Well, see, the thing is this, in the face, when you and I have to go out and face not just the evil that's in this world, but the evil that is of this world, you and I as Christians, we must strengthen ourselves. We must strengthen our lives with one thing and one thing only, and that is the pure food of God's holy word. But did you notice something there? Did you notice what he said, how we are to do this? Friends, you got to do more than just want it. You got to do more than just, well, I'll think upon the word. You notice he said what? You've got to crave it. You've got to desire God's word. You have to come to the point where you realize you cannot, it's not just not doing that, it's you can't live without it. It's you cannot live another day without the spiritual milk of God's holy word. But to do this, like I said, you got to do more than just think about it, friends. You got to live it out. You've got to make it become a part of who you are in your life. Why do we need to do this? Why is this so important? Because of what he also talks about there in chapter 2, verse 8. What happens to those who do not take within themselves that spiritual milk, who do not follow that life-giving word of God? What happens? You notice? You will fall down. You will stumble, and you will fall. And as a result, you will end up with the fate, the same fate that's been set aside for all those who do not follow or live out his word, who live upon the cornerstone. That's why we have to do this. So what is really going on here today? Why is God sharing with us from Peter's message this morning? If you've ever been blessed to go to San Antonio, Texas, they tell me that when you go to visit the Alamo, and when you go in there, that you'll discover near the main entrance the portrait of a man. And that portrait of this man has the following inscription beside it. It reads, James Butler Bonham, one of the heroes of the Alamo. No picture of him exists. This portrait is of his nephew, Major James Bonham, who greatly resembled his uncle. It is placed here by the family so that people may know the appearance of one who died for freedom. When I think about this, I also think about how I've been told, you know, how many portraits, how many paintings of Jesus are out there? Thousands? Of all the thousands upon thousands of paintings of Jesus, it's always been pointed out that there is no exact or factual portrait of him, that no factual portrait exists. But I'm here to tell you today, I believe in my heart that if Peter was standing here before us, he would want you to know that there should be no truth to that statement. That the image of Christ should be found where? In you and me. That every day people should see the living Jesus. To see the greatness, the fullness of who he is. That the likeness of the Son should be seen in each and every one of us. Because we are called. Because of what Jesus did. Because of what God has done for us. You and I, we are called to be the exact living portrait of Jesus himself. So that brings me now to two final questions. First off, when people see your life, whose portrait do they see? Do they see a portrait of Jesus, or do they just see you in the world? And secondly, when people see you, do they see you as someone living now out a holy life? Or when people see you, do they see nothing more than a dead stone? A holy life or a dead stone? The choice is now up to all of us. The choice is up to us now. What are we going to do? Will we be a portrait of Jesus? Will we be a holy life for him? Or will we just simply go through the service today and continue on through this week as a dead stone? What will you do with what God is sharing with us today? Those who are here with us, if you want to come to this altar on either side and stand or kneel, you are welcome. Those of you who are home right now, I know God is speaking to you too. And you're invited just to bow your head where you are. I hope you're there, maybe in your pajamas, your warm-ups, you're enjoying that cup of coffee. Set that cup down for a little bit, okay? Set it down. And bow your heads. And together, let's stop living. Together, friends, let's stop living as a dead stone. And let us now start living as someone in which the stone has been rolled away. To be the living Savior, alive in us. So what will it be for you and me this morning, for this day? I'm going to invite Jim and Beth Ellen to come forward, and we're going to have a hymn, a closing hymn. It's When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. And I looked at the hymn. Beth Ellen didn't know what I was preaching on. This was the perfect hymn. God has his way. And it's a short hymn, old hymn. We're going to sing all just four verses. And I invite you to let this be your prayer. Because like I told Jerry, I said, I can't select one verse or two verses. All four verses deal with everything that God has laid on our heart today. So let this be your prayer. Let this be your prayer at home, this beautiful, great old hymn. When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. Let's sing these four short, beautiful verses together this time.
I rejoice, gain, I can.
thank you once again for joining us, being a part of our service today. Thank you, those who are at home. Maybe you're traveling somewhere. You're a part of our service. We thank you for that. And we still want to know, hopefully we're blessing you in some way. Our church would love to know this. And so send us that email that's been on the screen, or send us a snail mail letter if you want to. Whatever it is, let us know, please, if we're blessing you in some way. Just lift our spirits in so many different ways you never know. So thank you again. Thank you all for being here. And now would you receive this benediction? Brothers and sisters of Christ, go forth now in the love and peace of our Lord and Savior. Go forth now to no longer live as a dead stone, but go forth now and live a holy life. For the one who came and showed us the true depth of our Heavenly Father's love and the power of His forgiveness when He went to the cross for each and every one of us. Let us now be a living, holy life for Him. And all of God's people together said, amen. Amen. God bless you all. And again, thank you for being here with us today. Take care. God bless. Goodbye.